Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the Lord. The Lord is good. All the time, the Lord is good. We are in His presence. We are in an era whereby His presence becomes so obvious. We are in an era whereby the presence of God will become so conspicuous. And I want us to, this very moment, understand that Jesus is doing something great. Something is happening. The reason why people are saying things are not happening is because you are not happening. I'm telling you the truth. Things are happening to the glory of God. Great and mighty things are happening these last days. There are a lot of things that are taking place. And I want you to understand that where the presence of God is, where the Spirit of God is, there is liberty. So, brother and sister, I want you to know that we are in an era where the impossible are becoming possible. Where things that are said to be difficult, they are happening on a platter of gold. Where things we negotiate for are given to us on a platter of gold. The name of the Lord be praised. God is in the midst of His people. I want you to understand, we are God's people. No matter what is happening in the world, no matter the calamity, no matter the chaotic disorder the world has gone into, God is still God. When you talk about God, and I want you to understand, nothing happens on the planet Earth without the awareness of God. Whatever thing that happens, God is aware of it. And God is in control. It's not the devil that is in control. It is God that is in control. So for this reason, I just want us to quickly bow our heads. If you are here right now, you are watching me live, I want you to please remain focused. Your focus on the matter that concerns heaven today is going to bring a turnaround to your life. You need to be focused. Paul said, this one thing I do. He's talking about focus. This one thing I do. And God said, you can eat of every fruit, but this one don't eat. He's still talking of focus. The reason why men and women don't succeed is because they break focus. When focus is broken, you are bound to have a distraction. And distraction will take you away from the plan of God. Hallelujah. The Lord is good and the Lord is mighty. So at this point in time, I just want us to quickly pray. Lord, we thank you, we give you praise, we give you honor, we give you adoration. We thank you this moment, oh God. Lord, as we have crossed half of this year, Lord, heading towards the end of the year, oh God, because we entered this year, we saw day one, and we have crossed the middle of the year, we are approaching the end. Lord, we will see the end of the year. We will cross over this year and enter a new season, a new reign of 2022, a double grace, a double victory, a double blessing. Lord, everyone tonight that will hear the sound of my voice, oh God, their life will be spared. Their life will be hid in Christ. Lord, nothing will terminate them. Nothing will bring their life to an abrupt end. Lord, they have seen it. They will enjoy the last miracle of the year. The God of the 11th hour. Lord, may you visit your people today to the glory of your name. Holy Spirit, move as you ought to move. Lord, touch the heart of people. Every spirit of distraction, I ban them and I destroy them right now. I ask that the Spirit of the Lord will move. And it will do that which no man could do. Lord, thank you. Thank you, Lord. We give you all the praise and we give you all the honor in the mighty name of Jesus. Men and brethren, I have been taking seats and I've been consulting heaven. I have burst into the realm of the presence of God. I have asked God, what will you have me deliver to your people? And by the special grace of God, God put in my heart to share with you today. Some of you may have expected this broadcast in the afternoon, But because of a lot of jam-packed program, other activities, so I couldn't really come in the afternoon. But anytime, God never come late. I believe this is the right time God wants you to hear his word. And the word of God is powerful enough to turn your life around. Because all you need, all the world need, is the word of God. The word of God is life and is spirit. It can turn a beggar to a prosperous man. It can turn a sinner to a saint. It can turn a prostitute to the distributor of the gospel. The word of God is powerful and it can turn life around. So today, as we approach the end of the year, as I've told you before, that we are just half, we've crossed the window of the month of December. We are approaching the end of December. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to get this clear for today, that the decision you took today is what has brought you to the position you are right now. The decision we also take today will also bring you to the position you will be tomorrow. So for this reason, I'm going to share with you on a message which I have tagged decision, or your decision determine your what? Your destiny. Your decision is what determine how your next year, 2022, will be. Because your next year is your future. Your next year is your destiny. Your next year is your tomorrow. What is your destiny? What is your future? Future means tomorrow. Yes, the decision you take today is going to be what is going to transform you into the type of person God wants you to be. Decision is very, very important, and decision is life. Decision is not something that is taken in rush or is taken in ash. Decision is not something you just wake up and begin to take decision. Decision is something you have to consider. You have to think about it, ponder about it heavily before you take a decision. So now this will take us to the scripture in the book of 1 Kings 12. In 1 Kings 12, that is where we'll be taking our scripture today. I think that is the only place we'll be reading. And I want you to follow me closely. The Lord is going to help you. Today I'm a man of God, not because somebody just said, become a pastor. Even when it was very obvious in my heart, when it was so clear, crystally clear, that God have called me to do his work. The first thing that I did is I sat down and I have to ponder over it. I have to think about it, whether to go ahead or not to go ahead. The Bible speaks about set time. And I have to think also what to do before that time that God wants me to take this mantle to begin to do his work. So hear me. In 1 Kings 12, the Bible speaks about the son of Solomon, which is called Rehoboam. Rehoboam was the son of Solomon. And Rehoboam was the one who reigned, who succeeded his father, Solomon. Now, something happened in the time of Rehoboam. This is what led me to the decision. After the death of his father, Solomon, then Rehoboam ascended the throne. He became a king because nobody lives forever. So, your decision in life will have a long way to affect people that are coming after you, people that are following your footsteps. Your decision matters a lot. Even children yet unborn, today we see a lot of things that have been done by people, some good things, some bad things. It was decision. Today we are reading about it. We have heard about president who have ruled with iron fist, who have ruled with a higher hand, a draconian reign. So we've heard about it, how they destroy. And we have also heard about good government, who have also ruled well. If in the Bible, we had a bad King Nebuchadnezzar, who was very wicked, who wanted to kill Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who turned into idol. Then at the end of his reign, God turned him into an animal. King Nebuchadnezzar became an animal. He went to the forest for 7 years because He didn't take a good decision. So what are we talking about? Decision is very, very important. So as I'm talking to you right now, may the Spirit of the Lord begin to help you to take a right decision how you will rule next year. Because your decision is what decides your destiny. Your decision is very, very important. Your decision is very, very what? Is very, very important. And I want you to understand this. So, please, I want you to know that today is a very, very important day that I have decided to teach every one of you about the Word of God that is going to help you. Because 2022 is already at hand. And I want you to understand that in 2022, if anybody comes to tell you that 2022, oh, it's going to be, you see manna will begin to fall from heaven. No. No year. Last year, people complained that last year was very bad. This year is even more worse than last year. It's going to be like that. It's going to be like that. There will never be a year that people will say, oh, last year was really, really bad. And this year is now better. No. Nothing like that. I must be playing with you. But the truth is, the Bible says God knows those that are his own. And in Romans 8:28, the Bible says all things work together for good, for to them that love God. Even people like them, Abraham, they fought so many battles. It was not easy. Look at somebody like Elijah, who at the end, at the later end of his life, he said, God, I'm discouraged. Take my life. So I want to tell you briefly about Rehoboam. Who is this Rehoboam in the Bible? You find the story of Rehoboam in 1 Kings 12. He was the son of Solomon, a great king that have ever lived. He was the son of Solomon, whom even Jesus, after the demise of Solomon, Jesus came and even referred to the greatness of Solomon. You know what Jesus said? Jesus said that Solomon, even in his glory, Solomon in his glory. That was Jesus have to even refer to his greatness. So now, after the demise, after the departure of Solomon, the son succeeded him, which is called Rehoboam. Rehoboam was the son of Solomon. Now what happened? When Rehoboam ascended the throne, then the first thing that he had to do was he have to come to himself. He have to say, now, how do I rule? How do I succeed my father? How do I a kind of asmount and at my testimony should outlive the one of my father? So he came to himself. He was wondering, he was thinking, what do I do in order for me to have a good record? My father have left a good legacy. Now let me also do something that will be greater and more powerful than the one of my father. He said before he will rule, he have to go and, you know, he have to find out, he have to meet with some people to advise him. That is where, who do you go to for advice? The Bible says that iron sharpened iron. Who are you talking with? Who is giving you advice? Who you follow? This determine what follow you. In life, who do you consult? Who do you take as a father? It's very, very important. Jesus said in the Bible, he said, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. In other words, everybody is mandated to have somebody you follow. Whether I know God is the one that we follow. The same Paul was also saying, imitate me as I imitate Christ. We are a product of somebody. Yes, God created you. He wanted you to follow somebody. You must have a father. You must have a mentor. You must have somebody that speak into your life. You must have somebody that correct you. You must have somebody that tells you this is how you should go. These are what we call fathers. These are what we call mentor. So this is what Rehoboam did. When Rehoboam ascended the throne, he had to go and meet with some people, to consult with some people, to counsel him, to give him an advice what to do and what not to do. Ladies and gentlemen, the first thing Rehoboam did in 1 Kings 12, let me read it. And it came to pass when Rehoboam, the son of Nebat, who was yet in Egypt, heard of it. I'm reading from verse 2 now because of time. Heard of it, for he was fled from the presence of King Solomon. And Rehoboam dwelt in Egypt. This, we are talking about Jeroboam now. Jeroboam is different from Rehoboam. Jeroboam was not the son of Solomon. Jeroboam was one of the officers that worked under Solomon. So when Solomon died, then the son came into power. Jeroboam fled to Egypt because it was the son was at an antagonist with this Jeroboam. Rehoboam was the son of Solomon, while Jeroboam was one of Solomon's officers who reigned and who ruled as a kind of, who was in charge of the tribute, the charge of money, in charge of the task. That was Jeroboam. So, and Rehoboam was the son. Then in verse 3, that they sent and called him, and Jeroboam and all the congregation of Israel came and spake unto him, unto Rehoboam, saying, thy father made our yoke grievous. Now therefore make thou the grievous service of thy father and his heavy yoke which he put upon us lighter, and we will serve thee. Hear me and hear me good. The Bible says, when Rehoboam ascended the throne, then the people of the land, his subject, they came to him. They said, ah, while your father was alive, he did a lot of things. The task, the heavy work he made us to do was so heavy. So please, we are not saying we will not cooperate with you. Please, now you are the son. You have ascended the throne. Power be given to you. So please, make our yoke lighter. Make our work very light. We will serve you. We will cooperate with you. There's nobody that don't need comfort. There's nobody that don't enjoy pleasure. There's nobody who does not believe in influence and affluence. There's nobody who does not believe in a comfortable life. So all those heavy work we have been doing, now your father is gone. Please make it lighter for us. Ladies and gentlemen, now look at what happened. Now, Rehoboam, the son of Solomon, he said, I've heard everything you people have said. He said, now let me think about it and let me take my decision. Now in verse 4, thy father make our yoke grievous. Now, therefore, make thou the grievous service of thy father and his heavy yoke, which he put upon us lighter, and we will serve thee. Verse 5, and he said unto them, depart yet for 3 days. Then come again to me. And the people departed. So Rehoboam took the right decision. He didn't just want to answer them immediately. He didn't just want to give them a correspondent a reply or action to what they needed. So the first thing he told them, he knew decision was very, very important. He said, you people should go. Give me 3 days. I will think about it. That's why they said, any decision you want to take, you must not take decision when you are angry. Any decision you take at the time you are angry, it will never work well. And any decision you also took when somebody offended you, it will not also take decision when you are offended or when you are not happy. It's just like they used to advise that when you want to marry, don't marry on Christmas Day. Because everybody is so beautiful. Everybody looks so splendid. Everybody looks so so wonderful on Christmas Day. So you can marry Satan because of the beauty pancake and the makeup. You can go and marry, what person. So after Christmas, and you now begin to know whom you have married to. So they've advised on Christmas Day, every woman are very beautiful, every man are also very handsome. So nobody is permitted to marry on Christmas Day, because the men we take care of themselves, wear their best dress, wear the best suit, the best haircut, just like my own. I have a good head cut now, though it's almost about 3-4 days that I had my head cut by one of my sons. So you see, yes, everybody wants to look good. It's very, even Satan himself. Why did the Bible say Satan also transformed himself to be angel of light? Satan also wants to look good. Satan is very, very, it's like a monster. The Bible calls him the whole serpent. a dragon. He's very ugly, but at times we make himself beautiful. He make himself okay. So now, Rehoboam said, don't worry. I've heard all that you have said. Give me 3 days and let me consult some people so that I can come with my final decision. Behold, Rehoboam, instead of him to have gone to the elders, to people whom their faculty, who is updated and upgraded, because everything, like that is why even your phone, they will send you a message, they will say, upgrade. There are some people who are still living in the era of analog. They are living, they have not yet upgraded. What you and I need is to be upgraded. If we're a lawyer, you see many lawyers, they are losing cases every day because they are not upgrading. There are some old law that have been revoked and they are still working on the old law. That's why you see many lawyers, they don't have clients. But a lawyer that have upgraded, who know what was served, he will be able to win cases because he knows the new rules. So that is why God wants us to be upgraded. You and I, we need to be on a very high frequency. We need to outsmart the devil. We need to be ahead of the enemy. So we should not live on the old life, on the past glory. So he said, give me 3 days, I will take my decision. Because any decision you take in harsh or rash, it will never be a good decision. Lo and behold, what he should have done, should have gone to elders. Ladies and gentlemen, in life, when you want to succeed in life, you must work with those who have done what you are trying, who have done it 3 times, who have done tries of what you are even struggling to do. When you want to succeed in life, somebody that had an experience, somebody that have gone through that road, they said the quickest way to get to a place is to find out from the person who is from that place. When I want to go to America, the fastest way to get to America is to find out from an American about that place so that I know when I get there. That is what the people said, that the greatest or the fastest way to get to a place, find out from the person who is from there. Because it's already aware of everything about that place. So, as we continue, in verse 6, so within that 3 days, Rehoboam have to do some consultation. He want to find out some advice. Hear me and hear me good. Who is giving you advice? How can you say you want to be a good wife? You are taking advice from people who are single. How can a married wife, a married woman, your best friend are people who are not married? I don't say, don't have a friend that are not married. But in fact, they say experience is the best teacher. Somebody who have had an experience is something you don't even learn in school. Experience is something you gain as a result of what you've been through. You know, the reason why Jesus succeeded, the second Adam, why he succeeded was because he went through everything. In Hebrews 5 verse 8, the Bible says Jesus Christ suffered in land of obedience as a result of what he went through. That was why Jesus succeeded, because he was born like you and I. He was not created, he was born by a Virgin Mary. The Bible says he grew up at the age of 12, the Bible referred to him in the temple. At the age of 33, he became a full grown man. He started his ministry. He went about, he suffered all that all human could suffer. But the first Adam was just created. He was not born. That was why he didn't have experience. So when temptation just came once, he fell flat because he never went through pain. He never went through suffering. The only time he was hungry, the devil just said, eat this ample. Oh, look at ample. He ate the ample because he had never experienced what they call hunger. He has never experienced anything. He was just created, a full grown man. He just opened his eyes, saw himself in the Garden of Eden. And he was eating. He never worked for anything. But Jesus was born. That was why the second Adam, that was why he succeeded. And he was able to stand. And he was able to make it. He made it and said, now all power on earth under the heaven is given unto me and in heaven. So he took the power from the enemy. because he went through experience. That's what Hebrews 5:8 said. Jesus learned obedient because of what he went through. Whatever thing you have gone through in life, it gives you an experience. It gives you edge over others. Experience matters a lot. You must go through it. It's just someone like me today. Thank God by the special grace of God, I'm still in ministry for over 30 years. Why? Because I became born again genuinely. And in those days, I was still in secondary school. No money. We trek to village. We trek 3 hours. We have seen things. So when God also brought me from the urban area to the city, from the rural area to the city, I have the experience. There are times everything will fail, but experience will begin to take you. Ministry is not just only about standing on the pulpit and begin to preach. It's experience. There are times everything fail. Then what help you now is the anointing and the experience you have gotten in all these years. Experience matters a lot. Amen. Hallelujah. So, I want you to understand that in life, you are able to succeed as a result of your stamina. It is the depth that determines the height. Like where I am today, the building I'm making my broadcast now is 8-story building. 8-story building. 8th floor. You know? Now, this 8th floor is able to stand today because of the foundation. The foundation is well solidified. The foundation is very, very strong. So, as a result of the foundation, that is why you see for many years, this house is still standing. So this is what I'm letting you know today. Decision in life is very, very important. Don't just take decision based on, as a result of the pains you are going through right now. Don't just take decision based on, as a result of, you know, what somebody did to you. No, decision is something that is very critical. Look at the way dictionary defined decision. He said decision is a conclusion or a resolution reached after consideration. You put everything into consideration. You put everything into what? Consideration. Before you say, I'm going to quit, think about it. If I quit now, how do I start all over? The person God brought to your life, who is the helper of your destiny, think about it before you say, no, it is over. I you can't help me again. Think, if this man have to live your life, who will not be helping you to take care of some of these little expenses? Some people say, not concern me, make it go. It goes who concern you. You don't just take decision like that. There are some people, there are some decisions you have taken that brought you so backward that almost about 10 years backward. Life is in 3 stages. We have the morning, we have the afternoon, and we have the evening of life. Right now, some of you are still in the morning of your life when you are supposed to be in the afternoon as a result of the decision you have taken. Somebody is helping you or where you are working as a director. People who labor, who put their life on the line to work at the money. At the end of the month, you take the money, you travel to other country to go and enjoy yourself with your family. Forgetting that there were people who work with you to be able to achieve this thing. And you are promising that we pay next 2 months. And these people were the people who worked the money out. And you took the money, you went to go and lavish it, you went to go and enjoy it, affluence, a life of affluence. Then as you now come, your best worker, your best advisor, they are not leaving you because You have taken a decision that have made these people to live your life. I'm telling you, decision, consider this evening. And I also want you to understand that now is either the decision will take you forward or the decision will take you backward. So Rehoboam consulted with the young boys, the people without experience, the people who are in town, boys who can just make $1 million now, and within 1 month they will finish it because they never went through suffering before. They never used their hand to labor. So when the fortune just came to them, when the blessing just came to them, they just, the first time they are seeing blessing, they just lavish it because they've never gone through tough time. They've never had an experience in life. As I told you, experience is not something you learned in school. You gain an experience as a result of what you've been through in life. Yes, Jesus learned obedience as a result of what he went through. Jesus succeeded because of what he went through in life. That was what gave him edge over the first Adam. The first Adam was just created. He saw himself as a full-grown fledged man. He saw himself in the garden. He has never experienced anything. That was why he just fell. The first temptation, he fell into it. And God drove him away from the garden. This was somebody who God breathed life into. The Bible said there is a spirit in man. The inspiration of God giveth him illumination. That inspiration, that breath of God was upon him. Do you know that the first Adam was so great, was almost operating in the frequency of God? And God after created everything, and God said, name everything. And in a speed of light, he went into the sea, he named the shark, because you have to see it and name it. He cannot just begin to say, fish is I see. You are, no. For him to go into the sea in a speed of light, he went into the sea and said, this is shark, this is tilapia, this is this. He named them in a speed of light. And for him to go to the sky and name all the birds, it was in a speed of light, in a twinkle of an eye. He has cut off in the spirit and named all the bird. This is ego. This is this. This is that. He named everything. He was so great. The realm he was flowing from was a realm of God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. He was equal like God. He had power. But what happened? The first temptation he fell because he never went through anything. He was just created. He opened his eye. He saw manner of fruit in the garden. He could eat everything. He never planted anything. He never had to sleep one day to wake up. He never had to clean the house. So experience is very, very important. But Jesus was born by Virgin Mary. Amen. So what I'm trying to tell you right now is this. Decision. The decision you take in life matters a lot. Before you take any decision, you have to give it a strong consideration. You have to give it a strong consideration. You have to think about it first. That's why I define decision for you. Decision is a conclusion or resolution reached after consideration. You must consider before you take any decision. If somebody says, come and do this thing, the Bible says, when sinner entice you, he said, consent thou not. Yes, it might look good. The Bible says, broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and narrow is the way that leadeth to eternal life. It might look good. It's not everything that glitter that are gold. I want you to understand that. The decision about anything, you have to think about it. Take your time. This was what Rehoboam did. The Bible says, Rehoboam, instead of him to have consulted with the elders, he went with the youth. He was asking them, what do I do now? How do I rule these people? Now that my father is gone, now that I've ascended the throne, please advise me, what do I do? Who is advising you? You a married woman, a girl that is not yet married is advising you how to stay, how to operate with your husband. The best advice he will tell you, because he has not experienced what family life is all about. He has lived his life a single. All your best friend as a married woman is, they are all single. They will tell you to go to club, go to party. Man must, woman must enjoy herself now. Eat when you are young. Who told you are young? Time is no more on your side again. I want you to understand that. Who is your best friend? A married man. You are always found in the company of young boys, in the saloon, in the bar, drinking with young boys. Because those who have nothing to lose. Once they finish drinking, they can sleep anywhere. But you that is married, or your best friend, they are single boys. They will not give you best advice. You go to a man who have ruled his house successfully. Make that person your best friend. Archbishop Benson Dawes has said, you know, the person you should admire, you should follow in life, is someone that have done tries of what you are struggling to do. And the only person that should also advise you and correct you, that can also correct you, is somebody that have also done what you have not done in life. It's very, very important. Your best friend are all unbelievers. There is no Christian among your friends. People who smoke, who drink, who womanize, who does all manner of unthinkable things. Those are the ones you are moving with. Which decision are you taking today? 2022 is already at hand. What is now, you should be able to know some things, how you will live in 2022. You should be able to take some decision right now. Don't enter 2022 before you say, oh, I want to make a new resolution. No. Now is the time. It's very, very important. Plan for 2022. Don't let 2022 come and meet you. This is what most of the fathers do today. They prepare these children. They prepare the future for them. They put money in their account. They build houses for them. They keep it, which is good. The Bible says a good man leaveth an inheritance for children. But they don't prepare the children for the future. You see children today, some will grow, they will sell houses. Once any little temptation, hardship, they will sell what they've inherited. They will sell the property. They come back to square one. Why? Because they succeeded in preparing the future for them, but they did not succeed in preparing them for the future. Thank God, the Father that gave birth to us, prepare us for the future. There's nothing I cannot handle today because I have learned life in a very different way, in a very hard way. Decision is very, very important. Who is advising you matters a lot. Is the person any ungodly advice? There's nothing good in the devil. Satan is Satan. Somebody is telling you, oh, before I had my child, it was native daughter. They sent me things from Nigeria. Yeah, when you just abort, it's not like, oh, please. Meet with people. This what happened to Mary. When Mary was pregnant, she had to look for Elizabeth, who also went through what she went through. Elizabeth was also barren. And Mary had never experienced anything pregnancy. He had to go and meet Elizabeth, her cousin. Decision. Think about it. What are you planning to do now? Please, don't just take a rash decision. Think about it. Take 3 days. And the second decision you take when you are angry is not always a good decision. When you want to take decision, it should not be the time you are angry or the time you are flexing or you are living in affluence. No. It must be, Rehoboam said, please give me 3 days. Let me think about this. Let me think about option to take. So the Bible said in verse 7 from verse 6, and Rehoboam consulted with the old men. Now listen, he went with the old men that stood before Solomon his father while he yet lived and said, how do ye advise that I may answer these people? Look at what the old men told him. Old men with experience, old men with senses. What old men are seeing ahead? When a little child climbs the palm tree, he cannot see it. They have advice as a result of their experience, their age. They have good things to offer as a result of what they have seen in life. Anybody who is successful, We have a successful advice to give to you because he was able to be successful because he took a successful decision. People who are not successful cannot advise you. People who are not having a right mentality cannot advise you. Because if their advice could work for them, they would have not been in that position today. If their advice, their wisdom worked for them, they would have not been in a pit today. They would have not been in that mess. So you look at people. Friendship are not by force, it's by choice. 2022, brother and sister, take decision to follow wise people. Take decision to live a godly life. Take decision to live a prayerful life. Take decision to follow Christ. Christ, the solid rock, we stand. Every other ground outside Christ, they are all sticky ground. It may look glittery, but it's never gold. Yes, the devil can offer you anything like he offered Christ. If only you can bow to me. Somebody can say, this is how I succeeded. Because a temporary success does not make it that God, you know, that you are right with God. A temporary success does not make you right. That does not what define you as a successful person. So say, I'm not even paying tithe. After all, God is blessing me. I don't go to church every time. The day I lie, that is when I go to church. But look at, I have everything that life could offer. God is blessed. No! Why are there many sinners who are still 100 years, 80 years, that don't even know God? They speak against God. The reason because they last to that extent because God is giving them long rope to change. If God is blessing you in your sin, let me tell you, that is not the true blessing. God is just only giving you chances, opportunity to be able to come back to Him. Everything has expiring date. I've seen people who had what they call liquid cash, who has made this money. But today, they are the poorest people on earth. Riches is not what qualifies you as a righteous person. Look at a rich, the Bible speaks about a rich young man who came to Christ. Very rich, a young man. He said, Lord, what do I do to inherit eternal life? Then Jesus said, the first thing you will do is, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, with your mind, with your soul, spirit, and body. He said, I've been doing all this thing. You know, I've been doing all this thing. I love God, this and that. Then Jesus said, there's still one thing you are supposed to do to make eternal life. He said, everything that you have, go and sell them and distribute to the poor. In other words, if you really love God, you will not pay your attention on this earthly material. That was what Christ was trying to see, if you truly love God. There are some of you, you rather die than to give God an offering. You rather die than to pay your tithe. You rather want to buy every houses in Italy than to say, let me buy even Bible that I want to use. That was what Christ was trying to see in this young man. If truly you say you love God with all your heart, as he professed to Christ, he said, yes, this is what I've been doing from my youth. He said, you still lack one thing. Go and sell everything that you have. Because somebody that really loves God will not value material things more than God. You can forego everything for righteousness' sake. David said, oh God, you can take my house, take my wife, take my children. He said, but don't take away your Holy Spirit. Psalm 53. Don't take away your Holy Spirit from me. Take everything. Look at Job. For good 9 months, he went through trials and temptation. But yet, he still said, my Redeemer liveth. Why Satan attacked Job was not just because of his money. It was because of the love he had for Christ. Now listen, even Satan took everything away from him. He also buffeted him. He attacked his head. That if was because of the money, Satan would have left him. You know what still happened? The Bible says, Job still said that, I know my Redeemer liveth. in spite of his condition. Satan attacked Job because of his relationship with God. Now look at what Satan went to did again. Satan went through the wife. He entered the wife and said the wife, he spoke to the wife that, the wife said to Job, why not curse God? Now break your relationship with God. Curse God so that you can die. You know what he said? He said, instead of me. So that was what Satan needed, to discontinue his relationship with God. That is what Satan is looking for. All this attack that is bringing to you, you put your hand on this, it's not working. And you know you are genuine. You are not living a life of sin. You are really serving God. You love God. Things are still difficult. It's because of your relationship with God. That is what Satan is after. He went into the world. The world said, curse God. Discontinue your relationship with God. You know what Job said? Job said, I know that my Redeemer liveth. He said, instead of me to curse God, I curse is that day that my mother gave birth to me. That was how he defeated the devil. Do you know, after that temptation, the temptation lasted for 9 months. The Bible says, when God saw the heart of Job, he even said, God, even if you yourself, you slay me, I will not still give up. I will still serve you. Though he slay me, I will still serve him. There are extent you get to in your Christianity. That is what we call your walk with God. You are not sure of your salvation. Nothing again can stop you of that can stop your salvation. Though he slay me, I will still love him. I will still serve him. Can you do that today? Some of you just lost your, or you lose your house. They gave you quit notice. You are no more in the church. You lost your dad. Because you lost your dad for 3 months, 4 months, you are no more coming to church. Your sojourner didn't come out from Renew, from police station. For that reason, your coming to church now is not dilapidating. You know, today you are in church. Next week you are not in church because you are getting weak. You know, you are getting weak. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. The Lord is good. So, Rehoboam went to go and consult with the elder. After he consulted with the elderly people, you know the advice the elderly people gave to him? People who are elder in the things of God. You might be 25 years old. You know, the age of Methuselah has nothing to do with the wisdom of Solomon. Methuselah was 969 years. They say it has nothing to do with the wisdom. So when we are talking about experience, Edda, we are talking about your experience with God. So who is an Edda? An Edda, a creator, that is not an Edda we are talking about because you have gray hair, because you are 50, you are 60. No. We are talking about you have no God, your experience with God. Itato. Jesus was 12 years old when he was preaching to rulers, lawyers of about 70 years. 12 years old child. Why? Because the Bible said the wisdom of God was upon him. He went to the elders, people who love God, people who cannot, who have been through or gone through what he is going through now. He went to them, he consulted from them and said, what do I do? These people have come to me that this is what they needed. What do I do now? Then the elder told him, said, the only way you can get the confidence of these people, he said, make the way they serve your father. If your father will pay them $2 per hour, pay them $3. Because with time, things have changed. The way the money they were paying our father in those days cannot solve issue. In those days, you can rent a house with a dollar. But now, to rent a house, we are talking of about $500, $600. Things have changed so fast. So please change their wages. Give them, don't make them to that heavy work. Don't give it to them again. There are machineries. There are what we call science has overtaken everything. What they can do with their hand now, there are some machines, trade them. Let them be able to work with instrument, with equipment. Trade them up. This is what, you know, the elders advised Rehoboam. Rehoboam said, okay, I've had you. He went to the young boys. Who are the young boys? The rainy one that can flow with everything, that can move with trend of life, you know, without experience. He went to go and seek their counsel. He said, now, guys, I have come. You know, I'm not the king. My father is no more. Now, the people of this land, they have come to me that they need some fair hearing. They need some one or two good things. So please advise me. The young one told him, hey, if you don't use out your hand, you must feast yourself. It must be a survivor of the fittest. You must use iron fist on them. Don't smile. Don't laugh. Don't play with them. Anybody that just misbehave, give it to them the way they need it. That was what the young one asked him. He said, now listen, go and meet them. Tell them that if my father, if he chastised you, you did something wrong. My father chastised you with a whip. Me, I'm going to chastise you with the tail of a scorpion. If my father made you to work 2 hours a day, I'm going to make you to work 20 hours. The young one advised him, Rehoboam, they say, when you behave like that, these people will respect you. You know what happened? The Bible said, he listened to the counsel of the young one. Which decision are you taking today? A native daughter has advised you, oh, don't go to church. There is a witch that is troubling you inside that church. A native daughter. When you know that the devil, the Bible said this, the flesh lost after the spirit, and the spirit is against the flesh. We are in a conflict, a spiritual war. You know, a native daughter cannot give you good advice. Somebody who is a non-believer that don't go to church, we only tell you, don't worry. This dream you are seeing is somebody is depicting somebody troubling you in the church. Or this and that. They say a depressed person, we always take everybody, everything that about you, when somebody is depressed, everything about you will be negative. You will live a life of suspicion. Everybody is a suspect. Once you dream, the dream is not good. Somebody who is close to you is the person behind it. Once you couldn't laugh or some certain things, some certain adventures didn't go well, you suspect this person, you suspect that person. This was the case of Rehoboam. He went to go and consult. I don't say to be a young person. There are young people today who have this intellect, who have the wisdom of God. There are young people like the president of France, Emmanuel Macron. He became a president at the age of 30 years. He had been ruling France since the age of 30 years. He was a young man. You see that? So many people, look at Jacinda of New Zealand. She is about 30-something years. She has been ruling New Zealand. Jacinda, the president of New Zealand, 30-something years. It's not the years I'm talking about. Somebody who have come of age, that is, of experience about life, who had an experience about life, matters a lot. The decision you take in life will go a long way to affect you. Somebody just offended you in a church. Oh, the next thing, somebody will advise you, not go that church again. That will not be church. Let me tell you, the greatest place you will see an offense is in the house of God. Because that is where Satan cannot fight Ogboni society, Ogboni people cannot turn against themselves because they already belong to the devil. The house of God that is against him, that is where Satan will want to bring quarrel, everything. So there's bound to be misunderstanding, even in the house of God. It doesn't mean that should not stop you from going to the house of God. Yes, it will happen. I want you to understand that. Somebody can offend you in the house of God. Yes, it's possible. We are human. They say that for one to make mistake is human, and for to forgive is divine. We can always offend ourselves. Any mistake you see in one church that make you to run away from that church to go to another one, you will still meet with the same mistake. There are many people today who have gone through all the churches. At the end of it, you see them say, I know they go any church again. That is the end. That is always the last stage of people like that. I know they go church again. Because you are always a complainer. You always see complain, everything. Pastor don't preach well. The choir not sing well. The women leader not do this. The pastor wife offend me. Pastor use me to preach. This and that. My brother, my sister, what is your problem? As a result of that, you are leaving the church. Now where you are working, many people have offended you. Why did you not pack away? Why did you not resign from where you are working? Because somebody offended you in your place of work. Why are you not leaving the place? Hallelujah. So I want you to understand that Jesus is coming to rapture a